And a very warm welcome to this lecture by Jeff Sachs. Jeff's going to be introduced by Professor Valpy FitzGerald, who is the Director of the Department of International Development, and the Oxford Martin School, which I'm the Director of, is proud to be hosting this event together with Green Templeton College. The structure will be that Valpy introduce Jeff. Jeff will talk for about 45 minutes. We'll then have a panel of distinguished people, and then hopefully there will be time at the end for Q&A. So do keep your questions in mind. We will get back to you. And without further ado, I'd like to introduce... And at the end, there will be drinks to celebrate our good timekeeping and our stimulating conversation. So drinks hosted by QEH for everyone, I presume, downstairs.
Yeah, with the dinosaurs.
With the dinosaurs. Valpy.
Well, good evening. I guess you can hear me. It sounds rather thunderous from here. That's fine. Well, it's my duty tonight, and a pleasant one, to introduce our speaker tonight. Jeff Sachs is not only a fellow international macroeconomist, which these days are a rather threatened species, being threatened not only by the global meltdown, but by microeconomists as well. But he's also a deep thinker on issues of poverty and climate change, and most recently, the political economy of the United States, in his recent book, which his lecture tonight is based on, The Price of Civilization. It's up there. I don't really need to recall Jeff's distinguished career to you. He was and still is a brilliant macroeconomist, an advisor to transition and developing countries, an institution builder at Harvard and Columbia, and now a polemicist, in the best sense of the word, in the classical tradition of political economy. There is, however, a particular reason why the two sponsoring institutions, that's the Oxford Martin School and my own department, have invited him tonight on the initiative of one of Oxford's leading younger scholars, Xiao Lan Fu, who's over there, who is really responsible for all of this. Because one of our core objectives in the social science division is to achieve an interdisciplinary approach to teaching and research and to ensure a sound evidential basis for policy design. At the Earth Institute, Jeff has achieved a remarkable conversation between natural scientists and social scientists, which we're, I wouldn't say envy of, we admire of, and new dimensions in the experimental validation of policy initiatives on the other. So we all have much to learn from the Earth Institute, and you will see from tonight's lecture the scope that it manages to embrace. I'm not going to spoil the lecture by revealing the plot details, although there is a murderer, in fact more than one murderer, but I won't tell you who it is, you'll find out, in this brief trailer. And I don't want to put you off buying the book for yourself or even for your aunts and uncles as Christmas presents because it's very accessible, the book, as well as being clearly argued with a wide range of evidence. The book as a whole, I suppose, is about the social contract, which is implicit in any functioning market democracy, and the philosophical underpinning of which is a central tenet of liberal moral and political philosophy, even in the work of such conservative theorists as Rawls in the theory of justice. But Jeff's USA is not the idealized contractarian policy of Rawls. It's much more historically rooted political economy. But I think the call for fairness that he makes is he shares with Rawls and in the great tradition of American thinkers reaching back all the way to the founding fathers of the Republic. However, Jeff's book reflects a different strand of the classical political economy tradition from the, if you like, the Rawls or liberal tradition, because he sees taxation as a central pillar of the democratic economy, not just as a source of collective funding of public goods, but also as a means to transfer income from the rich to the poor in order to ensure social cohesion. What this puts us in mind of course, is Rousseau, Social Contract, published 250 years ago, which informed the French Revolution much more than it informed the American Revolution. Indeed, the American Revolution was founded on the thought of one of our own graduates, John Locke, and set in train a constitutional pact which founded the United States, which in a sense is the origin of the problems in a way that Jeff will identify tonight. Indeed, the title of the lecture itself, as you may or may not know, is taken from the legendary legal opinion of one of America's greatest Supreme Court justices, Wendell Holmes, which states that taxes are the price we pay for a civilized society. It's so legendary that this is actually inscribed in stone above the entrance to the Internal Revenue Service headquarters in Washington, which is, if you're interested in these sort of, Masonic interpretations of history, is at 1111 Constitution Avenue in Washington. So, you know, obviously there's a novel to be written around as well as a serious book. And now, given the importance of the theme of tonight's lecture, I think it's not inappropriate that we're holding it in the same location, albeit upstairs it was, as the legendary debate on Darwin's theory of evolution 150 years ago in 1860, which was clearly concerned with the price of civilization in the sense of whether civilization was to be derived from science or from religion. And perhaps even more relevant is the fact that that same year, 1860, was the year that Abraham Lincoln was elected to the US presidency and South Carolina seceded from the Union. And indeed, America was about to pay the highest possible price for civilization. And so without further delay, I'd like to ask all of you to join me in welcoming Jeffrey Sachs to address us on the subject of the price of civilization. Thank you.
Valpy, thank you. You've already written the sequel. The Vatican Code meets the price of civilization. And indeed, all of the mysteries of our politics are at stake in the story that I want to describe for the next 45 minutes. And then I very much look forward to the panel discussion. We are this week, as everybody is aware, facing a critical moment in Europe's political economy. The survival of a monetary project that is under dire threat, and from that, the survival of the European project itself, which is under unprecedented threat if the Eurozone breaks down. Across the Atlantic, we're also in a political crisis of remarkable proportion. Yet in other parts of the world, there's a tremendous amount of dynamism. When one visits a lot of the rest of the world today, the question is, what's really happening in your region? Here things are going great. And I had an opportunity to be in Colombia a couple of weeks ago, and the sense was of boom, of dynamism, of advancement, of great excitement, and of puzzlement of what was happening to their northern neighbor that used to loom so large in their history and imagination, but now is a secondary actor compared to the true partner to whom they're selling, which is China, now their largest trading partner. So the backdrop for us today is a world that is, in a way, oddly upside down. I think explicably so, but still a world in which the high-income regions are in crisis, and the developing world, and especially a large part, which we now call the emerging economies, are fast growing and dynamic parts of the world economy, albeit regions which face their own tremendous internal stresses and which share with all of the world the biophysical stresses, which could turn out to be the defining element of economy and politics, as well as survival in decades ahead. Yet it is the case that we're in a world in which there is a generalized sense of high anxiety and institutional crisis in the rich world. And we need to understand this, I think, better than we do. There are certain things that are relatively straightforward to understand from mainstream economic thinking. The notion that if the conditions are right, that poorer countries should enjoy the ability to have faster growth than their richer counterparts by virtue of the ability to close technology gaps rapidly and thereby to achieve what we call conditional convergence or catching up growth is not all that surprising. And indeed, one of the great puzzles and questions for development economics and macroeconomics generally is why that sometimes occurs, why sometimes it doesn't occur, why countries occasionally experience moments of takeoff when what seemed to have been blocked is unblocked and catching up growth can continue. What I think is not by itself that easily explained is why it is that a country like the United States, which really has just about everything one would want within its borders, of tremendous human capital, a tremendous range of complex institutions, a robust constitutional process, a robust political system of representative democracy, should find itself in such a deep crisis right now. That does cry out for an explanation, and that's why I pondered this question over the last 3 years. It's not because I was naturally driven to write about and think about the United States, though that's my home and where I grew up and where I live and where I vote. I was hoping not really ever to write about the United States as an economist because it's not where my central interests have been and really where I regard the most important problems in the world to be. But it becomes palpable that when what was the world's leading economy and in many ways the world's leading geopolitical force over many decades not only experiences a relative decline of economic weight and power, which one would expect as others catch up, but falls into a political crisis that is extremely serious and into a set of social crises which call into question the ability to sustain what has been achieved up until now, you feel more or less compelled to think, at least think for oneself about what is underway. And that's what this book is about. And it's I don't think it's a finished attempt by any means. All you're seeing is the third manuscript, because the first two went into the wastebasket as I tried to get a more acceptable appreciation of what's happening. I feel that our political system is deeply broken. And that representative democracy in the United States is in peril in one specific sense, which is that it seems not to represent any realizable and well recognizable definition of public opinion or public interest. And how this should be and why this has come about, I find both very disturbing and very puzzling. The U.S. has not always been this way, and for me, a comparativist, I'm basically comparing years in which I grew up which I think I understood at least in some facsimile of the truth, from the 60s, 70s, and early 80s to the kind of society in which the U.S. has evolved since, and I find the comparison both unnerving but also indicative of the fact that society and political economy have changed. They've changed in a deleterious way, and I think they've changed not in an inevitable way, but in a way that is probably ultimately correctable, though when one is in crisis, you should never gamble on any automatic correction, because crises don't make solutions. Crises often make worse crises. And there's absolutely no reason to believe that one is in a sinusoidal process. One can simply be in an explosive collapse. And you never know until you're through it whether this is something that will be corrected. The one thing I'm sure that we're not, though most of my colleagues feel that we are, is in a business cycle, because that is how our current crisis is mostly interpreted and how our current policy is organized right now. We hit a massive recession starting in 2007, according to normal business cycle dating. We had the weekend of all weekends, September 12 to 15, 2008, when probably one of the world's worst, if not, and certainly in absolute magnitude, by far the world's worst financial crisis broke out, with the simultaneous collapse of three major institutions that weekend, Lehman Brothers, AIG, and Merrill Lynch, that suddenly led to a cascade of financial panic and illiquidity around the world, and a very, very deep recession that followed. And the mainstream view in the Obama administration, our governing administration, was that this was a bad business cycle that required a Keynesian stimulus policy that would moderate the downturn and bring us back to self-sustaining growth. That still may prove to be the case. If it is, I apologize for the book, because the book takes issue with that notion. But that is the dominant view. And if in the next year we have 5 to 6% economic growth recovery, unemployment comes down to 5%, everybody's happy again, and so on, I'll be surprised. It's not impossible, since none of us really understands these phenomena at the level of prediction. We only can understand them at best at the level of imperfect explanation. But my view is that, as I was trying to piece together for myself the events that led up to 2008 and the sequelae in the policies that have been chosen since early 2009, starting with a Keynesian stimulus and a zero interest rate monetary policy called quantitative expansion, QE1 and QE2 and the great longed for QE3 and so forth, that these were somehow not appropriate to the real circumstances, and that they themselves reflected a kind of perversion of ideas and knowledge in which our profession, my profession, macroeconomics, is complicit. Because I think one of the great weaknesses of macroeconomics in the last 25 years has been the idea that one could learn a set of techniques, but at the same time forget about the economy. Because macroeconomics, after all, aims to be a set of technical methods for flying an airplane to make sure that the pressure is right, that pressure gauges are properly read, that more thrust is given when it's needed, that less thrust is given when one needs a soft landing, and so forth. But one doesn't really have to understand much about the airplane that is ostensibly being flown, and indeed that's considered a nuisance. All those details about sectors and individuals and the microeconomics that we heard briefly mentioned as the threat to this profession and so forth. And I do believe that macroeconomics is not acquitting itself adequately in this period, in part because of its trained decision not to understand many pertinent deeper trends in the economy. When I began, therefore, to try to understand, and I had a gut feeling at the beginning of the Obama administration that this stimulus that was being proposed was wrong-headed on many grounds, tactical as well as strategic, and I tried to understand why I felt that way so strongly, contrary to most of my colleagues. My own exploration was to go backwards, to try to understand the roots of the 2008 crack-up. Where did that come from? And of course, to understand the roots of a phenomenon like a financial crash, one is inevitably led to financial mechanics. How did the credit system expand credit and why? To all of the mechanisms of financial innovation of the last 15 years and the specific mechanics on Wall Street. But one is also led inevitably to political economy. Why were decisions taken and what motivated the actions that were taken? And to my view, the crash of 2008 followed directly from policy decisions that were taken a decade earlier to deregulate the financial markets. And what was notable about those decisions were that they were bipartisan, led by another Democratic president, Bill Clinton, creating a new set of Wall Street institutions that one might not have normally associated with the Democratic Party, just as one might not have associated the City of London with New Labor before Tony Blair and Gordon Brown. But it's a similar phenomenon of political economy that occurred in both countries, the championing of financial deregulation, the intertwining of powerful financial interests with an ostensibly left-of-center political base, and a massive financial crash that followed. And if one wants to very personalize this, if one were a journalist, I would start out with, but it's not just journalism, it's also real history, the great perversity of the following fact, and that is that the deregulation effort was led by a U.S. Treasury Secretary, Robert Rubin, who had come straight from Goldman Sachs into the White House. He was chairman of Goldman Sachs. Then he became head of the National Economic Council in the White House. Then he became the Treasury Secretary. He presided over the financial deregulation till the last moment when he stepped down and handed it to my former colleague Larry Summers to complete the deed. And then Robert Rubin showed up as head, second in command of the firm that his deregulation had enabled, Citigroup, because the whole deregulation effort was directed to allow the creation of Citigroup, which is an amalgamation of a bank and then several other financial components that under U.S. law in the Great Depression, the so-called Glass-Steagall legislation, was illegal to combine, but which became legal upon the 1999 Financial Act. Mr. Rubin then sat in the corner office of Citigroup for 8 years and amassed $126 million of salary during that period, at which point Citigroup crashed and became insolvent, at which point Mr. Rubin said, well, I had nothing to do with that. I was just sitting in the corner office. The fact they paid me $126 million is a mere happenstance. We never really heard from him why they would have paid him for that, but he denied any executive responsibility. But to finalize the story, when the financial crash occurred, a few days later, candidate Senator Obama appeared with his advisors to show that he could get a grip on the situation. And who sat next to him? Robert Rubin. And that, to my mind, is a puzzle. It's a good novelistic puzzle for Valpy's sequel. I can now see the movie rights to it. The back scenes will be very interesting. But it is a puzzle from a political economy, sociological explanation, and I would also argue a common sense explanation. I had been able to get in one call to the Obama campaign to a senior campaign official the day after the financial crash, because I was a kibitzer on the sidelines, very much supporting candidate Obama. And I said, by all means, one thing you should not do is have Robert Rubin come in at this moment. And there he sat next door to give you a measure of my influence, if you would like it, which is precisely zero, or maybe actually wholly deterministic with a negative sign, certainly not any positive influence on any of these events. But if one takes this financial deregulation backward in time, there is a longer history, of course, because this was the second major financial crash of the United States in 30 years, after a period of almost 50 years where there was no financial crash following the Great Depression and the rules that had been put in place. Basically, from 1933 until when the American banks almost died but recovered on the wonderful words of Franklin Roosevelt about fear itself, to 1980, there was no financial crisis in the United States of any magnitude. But the first one came in the mid-1980s following the deregulation of the savings and loan industry. And that was almost to a functional point on what happened in 2008. Except that it involved a much smaller set of characters, specific organizations that were charged with taking finance to finance housing. In that sense, it was actually the same sector of the economy that ended up in crisis. But it was only small banks, not Wall Street at the time, so it didn't have an international spillover. And it left the US taxpayers with about $150 billion of debt. Of obligation to clean up those institutions. But it raises another political economy question, which is why did it happen twice, almost the same way, and why were certain actors in this process continuous actors all the way through, including Mr. Greenspan, for example, or Robert Rubin and others. So as I took the story in my own mind back to try to understand these events, I decided that a plausible starting point where one could actually see a shift of institutions, performance, and political economy in the United States was the 1970s. There was a period of roughly 35 years or so where American politics was built around a certain kind of consensus that had formed in the Great Depression, in World War II, and in the post-World War era that was both Democratic Party and Republican Party that had the kind of institutions that I imbibed as a student at the feet of Paul Samuelson and his disciples, the notion of a mixed economy that was built on a market institutions combined with a vigorous role of government in several sectors of the economy. In the 1970s, a transition occurred in economics and in politics, in my opinion, that has affected not only the United States, but also the story in Europe and the rest of the world. the 1970s was a tumultuous decade because it had the same features of high global instability as our current period. In 1971, the Bretton Woods exchange rate system collapsed. In 1973 and 74, we had the first dramatic spike of primary commodities prices, not unlike what we're living through right now, but absolutely shocking then when OPEC came into existence and asserted its market power, when food prices soared. We had a decade of high inflation following the breakdown of the Bretton Woods system, not hyperinflation as in many poor countries, but double-digit inflation in much of the US and Europe. And we had a beginning of the loss of the manufacturing base in both Europe and the United States. The peak employment in US manufacturing occurred in 1979. And we can understand looking back, and we felt it at the time, that this was related to the changing world economy and to the rise of significant new industrial powers. The dramatic one at the time was Japan, and little did we know that Japan's competition would be even a small facsimile of a much more tumultuous event, which was the rise of China, which began really in 1978. Though that's only a date that we look back on, because at the time that Deng Xiaoping came to power, I don't think anybody suspected the eventual impacts in the world economy. So my view is, to put it in shorthand, that the 1970s marked a new phase of the world economy. It was the end of the Reconstruction after World War II and the recovery of the so-called first world economies, as they were called at the time. And it was the opening up of most of the rest of the world to a, if not a single market, an integrated market economy. And we've been living, I believe, with the shocks of that phenomenon since then. And it has caused major changes in employment patterns, income distribution, and political economy. Now, at the time, it was, of course, not recognized this way. And what started in the United States in 1981, politically, I think, created 30 years of political consensus among the elites and among the elite political institutions that were not unlike the consensus from the mid-1930s until the early 1970s, but in a completely different direction. Ronald Reagan came to office on January 20th, 1981. And he brought with him a new set of constituencies, a new ideology, a new power base, which was in the Sun Belt of the United States, and a new approach to governance that was fundamentally different from the New Deal to Lyndon Johnson to Richard Nixon era, which was all of a piece itself. The most important statement that Ronald Reagan made as president was made on his first day of the presidency in his inaugural address, when he uttered some famous lines, which I dearly hope will never be chiseled above any building in Washington, when he said that that government is not the solution to our problems. Government is the problem. And the philosophy was not unlike Mrs. Thatcher at the same dates here. The philosophy was that the instability that we had observed in the 1970s was an instability due to the hypertrophy of government, the overgrowth of government in our societies, and that what was needed was the dramatic retrenchment of government to unleash market forces once again. Both Mrs. Thatcher and President Reagan made essentially a domestic diagnosis. They made a very similar one. They were reciprocal influences, and they were a team the same way that the odd duo of George W. Bush and Tony Blair became an even odder team later. But they were a team, and they made a domestic diagnosis which harked back to ideas of Hayek and Friedman, poorly interpreted, by the way, but harked back to intellectual ideas about the overgrowth of government. Reagan did some basic changes in the United States that lasted till now. The first was a dramatic cut in tax rates at the top of the income distribution. Both the highest reduction of the top personal income tax rate, the reduction of taxation on capital gains, many, many other detailed reductions that allow hedge fund managers to have a top tax rate of 15%, even though they're often among the richest people in the country and often taking home paychecks of hundreds of millions of dollars a year. Second, a dramatic reduction of government spending on goods and services for the public. Reagan tried and did not dismantle the major transfer programs in the United States, Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, and so on. But he did succeed, his administration succeeded, in sharply cutting spending on public investment and other goods and services, infrastructure spending, science and technology, job training, education spending, community development, low-income housing, family support, were all slashed, and in the aggregate were cut by half relative to the size of the national economy. The third thing that Reagan did was deregulation of key sectors of the economy, and the most important deregulation occurred in the financial markets. Second was in the environment, because Reagan deliberately took on and effectively succeeded in breaking the back of environmental regulation, which has been fighting an uphill battle in the United States since that time. And there was also deregulation of the media that also has had very powerful consequences for public discussion, public debate, ownership, concentration of information in a few major media conglomerates at the same time. Those changes have persisted for 30 years. Reagan made no diagnosis whatsoever about the role of the global economy. There never was a diagnosis about the role of the global economy, and there never was what I regard as a diagnosis about the sources of instability in the 1970s and what they portended for the future. So in essence, my argument is that the U.S. went to the doctor in 1981. It got a diagnosis and a prescription. It happened to be a quack doctor, and it happened to be a wrong diagnosis, and it happened to be a dangerous description. And we've now been on the wrong medicine for 30 years, and it's killing us. And it poses many questions, this kind of argumentation. But probably the main one is, if it's so wrong, why does it persist? And the argument, essentially, that I make in the book is it persists because political economy, largely because of the nature of power and money, no longer represents public opinion and even less public interest. There are two questions that are always asked. If it's so bad, why do the public vote for these characters or for these policies? And the fact of the matter is they don't vote for these policies. We don't have elections on policies. We have elections on candidates. And we never know what we're getting. We voted for Obama for change, and we got continuity. and you don't know that when it happens. Moreover, the policies that we do get do not map public opinion. So I would say that as a general matter, if you look at majority opinion in opinion surveys, that has relatively little to do with the actual votes and decision making that emerge from our political system. That's a broken linkage. It's not that the public has been hoodwinked and has been led to self-defeating strategies through ideology or propaganda, though there's a lot of that. It's that the public is actually deeply annoyed in the United States. The approval rating for Congress is 9%, which is statistically different, probably not statistically different from zero. I can tell you, in the course of 3 years of thinking about this and writing this book, I have not met anyone in that 9%. But then again, I don't know too many lobbyists, I suppose. And so they probably would be quite happy. But I think one could argue, if I were a political scientist writing a pure political science book, I probably would have written the book on the disassociation of public opinion and public outcomes in the United States, and therefore the failure of political representation as being nearly complete. What is represented, not, I think it's pretty obvious now, but I argue at some length in the book, are a few powerful interests. Those start with Wall Street. Second is big oil and big coal. Third is the private health providers industry, which is 17% of the US economy. And the fourth are military contractors, which are about 3% of the US economy. So we have ended up with a corporatocracy where public opinion maps quite closely to the interests of particular incumbent sectors of the economy. And the real institutional diagnosis is how does an entrenched duopoly of parties compete on non-price competition over 30 years so that both essentially carry on a continuous policy of catering to some powerful supporters and do that in an electoral democracy. And the answer is you partly get away with it by running large budget deficits for a long time because you can temporize on many things if you spend openly. But a large part of it simply is that the public has become less and less trusting, and the legitimacy of government has fallen dramatically. And there is a pervasive sense in the United States that none of the above is the leading candidate for just about any position in federal office. This is a massive crisis of political legitimacy, I would say. And it finally begs the question of what to do, and I'll stop here. And the 50 slides I was going to show you are all in the book. I will show you, no, I won't even show you one or two until we get to discussion. But let me say why we're in this perverse situation above all. And that is that we have created a political economy and entrenched a political economy in which money in three different ways, lobbying, campaign contributions, and insider trading by people in power, dominate the political process. And about $7 to $10 billion passes through direct lobbying and campaign contributions per year right now, a few hundred senior politicians. The more evidence we find, the public outlays are as politicized whenever there's discretion, and the private decision and the public decision making is privatized whenever there's discretion, so that congressmen are actually heavily engaged in insider dealing for their own accounts. This is legal in the United States. It's considered a loophole. I would call it a core feature of our democracy right now. It's not exactly a loophole. It was just something that wasn't supposed to be found. That was the loophole, that somebody wrote a book about it. But it's a major reality. And of course, it's serving the interests of these constituencies in particular ways. For oil and coal, the main goal is to avoid any kind of regulation, climate change, or other, and any kind of serious competition from alternative energy sources. They're succeeding mightily in that. For arms contractors, it's quite obvious it is to continue to defend against the Soviet invasion at all costs. That can go on until we're at the 50th anniversary of the end of the Soviet Union. But we have to appreciate how important these weapon systems are for American democracy. For the health insurers, it is to ensure that the world's highest priced healthcare system is never reformed. And that has been successfully effectuated again. And for Wall Street, it is to ensure that deregulation allows for the fulminant, flagrant, reckless use of other people's money, which enables massive bonuses, rain or shine, for the heads of the industry. And for all of them, to ensure the tax rates remain low at the top level. The essence of of the solutions, and I'll stop here, is that if government could be wrested from the grip of these forces, and there are reasons to believe that it can, if government could be wrested from the grip of these forces, the question is, what would one do with it? And my argument is that one would try to return to the mixed economy that produced the balanced, prosperous, and inclusive era that was a better era for the United States, and that continues to produce the balanced, prosperous, and inclusive economies of Northern Europe, which I take to be the best performing economies in the world today, the Scandinavian economies, Netherlands, and Germany with some modest footnotes and caveats, but especially the social democracies of Northern Europe, which I regard as the most balanced, sensible, responsible, prosperous economies in the world. They all rely on a large level of public expenditure to meet three requirements. One, the provision of public goods. Two, the adequate redistribution of income to ensure not only a level of fairness, but an ability of poor families to invest in the human capital of their children. Or to put it another way, the ability to ensure that poor children have the investments in human capital that they need to be able to be productive and prosperous members of their society. And third, environmental sustainability. And that requires a pretty hefty public bill. And my argument is the United States not only is not doing that because of particular pressure group forces, but also we can't afford to do that on the fiscal system that we have. My guess is that such an arrangement requires 40 or 45% of national income to pass through the budget, because that is the kind of level of transfer payments, as well as public expenditures, needed to face fairly fundamental needs like health, public education, infrastructure, science and technology, labor market investments, environment. And the United States is not at 40 to 45% of GNP, it's at about 25 to 30% of GNP in collection of revenues. So I argue we're not paying the price of civilization. We've allowed a phenomenal amount of income and wealth to accumulate at the top of the income distribution. We have allowed powerful corporate interests to guide our policy consistently for 30 years. It's a shame for the world because the United States is still the world's largest economy. It is still the world's most powerful country, though it takes no constructive actions on almost any global decision making anymore. Its quality of leadership has declined almost to nothing. By that I mean not that it is absolutely hostile to solutions, but it's at best neutral right now. Behind the scenes, it's mostly stopping useful things rather than promoting them. If Durban succeeded in anything this week, it would be almost against policies of the United States, which has essentially taken the view that in processes like Durban or like Rio Plus 20 or other international processes, don't agree on anything. Because if you agree on something, I have to bring it back to Congress, and that will be bad politics in the inner sanctum of Washington. So we have basically not only a collapse of U.S. political economy, but a collapse of global political economy because we're without a leader. Nobody else wants to step into this gap at this point. And so crucial global decision making is basically paralyzed at this point, especially on environmental issues, but also on financial regulation, on conduct of taxation, tax havens, and many other things that are needed at the global level to plug massive holes in the international governance structure. So I'll end with one cheery note, just one. We've been here before in the United States on at least two occasions, and both times there was self-correction. The first time was about 120 years ago in what became known in American history as the Gilded Age, which was the first time major corporate power had a continental scale reach in the United States. And it quickly organized itself into a series of monopolies around rail, around the new oil industry, around steel, and a few other major industries. These were the trusts at the end of the 19th century. And they led to so many abuses and so much inequality that it provoked first a prairie populist movement among farmers in the U.S., an anti-urban, anti-Wall Street sentiment. And The Wizard of Oz, by the way, is a parable from that time. And Oz is NY, New York, raised one letter to OZ. Because the Wicked Witch of the East was the evil for the Midwest farmers, it was an anti-Wall Street parable when first written. And what followed the populist movement was the progressive movement, which was an incredibly fruitful 25 years of reform of American democracy, which led to women's vote, the graduated income tax, the creation of the Fed, which was better than not having a Fed, implementation of fair labor standards, antitrust actions, and all the rest. It was led by a Republican initially, Theodore Roosevelt, who came to power because his boss was shot. He was meant to be useless vice president who could deliver New York State in the 1900 election, but suddenly he became the youngest president in American history took on powerful interests and became the first great progressive president. And he was followed by Woodrow Wilson in 1913, and the progressive era lasted until 1917. Until America entered World War I, because wars are tremendous ways to kill reform and progress and everything else. Second progressive era was led by Teddy Roosevelt's sixth cousin, Franklin, but he was also a nephew by marriage because he married Teddy Roosevelt's niece, Eleanor. And Franklin Roosevelt really completed, in a way, the progressive era, but he also launched that 30 years of what I grew up believing was the mainstream and irrevocable mixed economy of the United States, the era of Social Security, the era of Glass-Steagall financial regulation, the era of the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, and of the Securities and Exchange Commission, and the notion that the economy rested on regulation and redistribution alongside the market economy. So there's a good piece of news. We've been there before, and self-correction occurred. And 11 weeks ago, a group of young people occupied Zuccotti Park in Wall Street. It's a tiny little park, if you Google Earth it, almost insignificant in size. And yet, in 11 weeks, it changed the US discourse, which tells you how low the legitimacy is of our institutions right now. Because a few thousand kids forced a self-reflection that hadn't happened in 30 years. And one foolish banker after another made one foolish statement after another, which only amplified what the young people were saying, because the more these bankers spoke, the more disgusting they were shown to be. And it didn't take a few weeks of that kind of feedback to convince all of America that bankers truly are disgusting in their self-regard, in their arrogance, in their impunity. Not all bankers, just the ones that came before the camera. And interestingly, yesterday, Obama gave a speech in Teddy Roosevelt's home base in Kansas. It's not his hometown, because Teddy Roosevelt was a New Yorker through and through. But where Teddy Roosevelt had given a famous speech calling for a square deal for America in 1910, and Obama reprised it yesterday. Now, Obama is a wonderful speech maker, and so far exceedingly mediocre president. The speeches and the governance have been disconnected up until now. And I don't give the speech, therefore, credence at the moment. But what I do find is that it's fascinating that President Obama decided to channel the progressive era yesterday. This is a change of times that's possible. This is how public opinion can work in the United States. Even our governor, who a few weeks ago was rejecting any rise of income taxation of the rich, reversed himself yesterday and called for higher New York State tax rates on the wealthy. It shows how change can come, and I believe that we may be at the start of a new 30-year cycle where the private greed is once again replaced by public purpose. Thanks very much.
International Development has been the chief economist at the UK's Department for International Development, and I've already introduced you to Professor Valpy FitzGerald, who's the head of the International Development Department and professor of International Development and Finance. We did have a woman, I'm glad to say, up here, but she was unable to be here at the last minute, so I'm sorry it's an all-male panel, but it's an absolutely terrific panel, and I'm sure they'll have very interesting things to say about Jeff's book. We'll start with Professor Sir Adam Roberts. They've each got 5 minutes, and then we'll have a little discussion amongst the panel before turning to you.
Well, I'm the least qualified person to be on this panel by far. I'm not an economist, nor am I a specialist in the United States. I did work at the London School of Economics for 15 years, and that gave me a certain skepticism, one might say, about economists, because first of all, I distrusted the belief that they represented a more scientific approach or had a greater predictive power than the rest of us. And I think my skepticism has since then been proved justified. And I also thought that they had a tendency, including development economists, to universalize. And it's one thing that has worried me about some of Jeff Sachs's past work, that he has applied, as it were, sometimes universal rules to particular situations, and it didn't work out quite as it should have done. But I don't want to go over that ground again, because today, very clearly, he indicated a very discriminating approach between different parts of the world, different countries, noting that some developing countries have achieved development when others haven't, and it's hard to explain in any simple terms why that should be so. Certainly in simple, there are no simple economic explanations as to why that is so. So my disagreement with him, if there is one, is not there. And in fact, I'm going to be a very disappointing panelist, because I don't have a fundamental disagreement with anything that he has said. Indeed, I stand in admiration much that he has said. Where I do have questions is precisely in the area he indicated towards the end. That's to say, what constructive proposals come from this. And I have very many fewer questions to do with his diagnosis, other than that I'm not sure that his concentration on the United States and his justified observations about the United States stand in such sharp contrast to Northern Europe as he presented. We have problems aplenty, including in the better-run countries of Northern Europe. I'm not just speaking about Britain at the moment, but there are problems aplenty there with social democracy in acknowledged difficulty in Northern Europe and problems about the mixed economy there. And it seems to me arguable, and here I'm in danger of being a universalist myself, that there is a problem to do with democratic politics at the heart of much of our current crisis, that politicians generally, not just American politicians, do not like facing up to hard truths, imposing hard measures, or being honest. That may explain why it is democratic societies that have gone on the binge borrowing to an unprecedented degree, and why it has become extraordinarily impossible for any British politician to stand up and say he thinks that income tax ought to be increased, when it seems to me that there is a moral case to be made and a serious argument that if we have underfunding of public goods that people value, there is a need for income tax. But that's a problem of democratic politics more generally. The questions I have about what might the direction that his diagnosis might, Jeff's diagnosis might take us in, have to do not only with taxation, but also with what you might call the inherent problems of free trade. Whether we're talking within Europe or whether we're talking globally, it seems to me that some of the warnings about the consequences of free trade have been borne out. That if you have a world in which very cheap labor can produce wonderful goods, which we then buy, you are destroying local industry, and completely blameless people are put on the scrap heap locally because of the global economy. And for all the merits of that system, it has, as we have seen, huge cruelties as well. And then on top of that, there is the issue of whether the international trade that we see within Europe is also part of the cause of the euro crisis. The doing out of undermining of industry in the Greeces of this world to allow for the more efficient and better run economies, such as that of Germany, to succeed better. It's a really difficult structural problem. And part of my recommendation, I'd be interested to know whether Jeff Sachs would agree with it, is one that as a non-economist I make with diffidence. But I do think a world of a casino where people invest in shares one day to sell them the next, they're in for a very quick buck, rather than investing in an industry because they think it's a sound long-term investment that deserves support. That casino world is part of the root of our trouble. And some kind of tax, to however small, just a instant electronic transaction of goods seems to me to be one of the recipes that might be useful in addressing this problem. And finally, I can't resist from saying that it does seem to me that governments, including democratic governments, have been astonishingly cowardly in addressing the grotesque pay that bankers award themselves. Bankers seem to me to have got to the state, which is exactly the same as that famous bank robber whose name I forget. Was it Willie Horton?
Willie Sutton.
Willie Sutton, that's right. Who, having done one of his many jail terms, is interviewed and asked why he keeps robbing banks. And he looks pityingly at the interviewer and says, "That's where the money is." The attitude of bankers now is identical and problematical. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Sarna. Peter.
Sure. Willie Sutton actually never said that. He actually publicly was quoted as saying, "That's a great line, but unfortunately I never said it."
Another myth bites the dust.
Another myth bites the dust. So I'm honored to be here.
He stole that line.
to discuss this book, The Price of Civilization, Reawakening American Virtue and Prosperity. I want to focus on the subtitle because there's a lot in this book about reawakening virtue and prosperity that we didn't get a chance to hear so much about, and I might talk more about that. So one of the points made in the book is that we have to be more mindful, and there's nothing to make you more mindful as a reader than knowing you have to get up in front of an audience this big and discuss a book. But unfortunately, despite my mindfulness, I found more to agree in this book than to disagree with, at least in the first half. Perhaps it comes from my point of view. Like Jeff, I was born in the United States and spent my formative days in a freshwater economics department. But I think it's more than our similar backgrounds. I think I've also been studying financial system for the last 20 years and the situation of low to moderate income Americans, and therefore much of what you say rings true. And it's not all about the biases. It's because the first half of this book is extraordinarily well written and well documented. It paints a sobering picture with, I believe, 137 footnotes in the first half about a diagnosis of America. And I think Jeff did a great job, but it's a diagnosis that has a lack of confidence in government, low levels of savings and high levels of debt, stagnant levels of happiness, income inequality, a sunbelt, snowbelt rift, a misguided faith in markets and deregulation, an unbalanced budget driven by high defense spending and too low tax rates, pressure from a global economy, depletion of natural resources, and a political system rigged to support the wealthy. Finally, we're a distracted study society, a point I would have understood a lot better had I not been reading the book while I was eating and also watching TV. All these critiques are true up to a point. Some of them are a bit over-argued, and I think, as my fellow panelists mentioned, they have to be put in context. For example, one study that I recently did with some colleagues looked at 13 different countries and asked a simple question. Can you come up, in the U.S. at least, with $2,000 in 30 days? The number was 1,500 pounds here, and a shocking 46% of Americans couldn't come up with that number. Can come up with that amount, whether by friends, family, savings, or whatever. The equivalent number in the UK was 49%. So what you're describing, unfortunately, is not not about the US as much as you might like. So as I said, I don't have much to critique about the first half of the book, but I do have questions about the second half, and perhaps it belies where I come from. I come from a business school, and we spend time thinking about implementation and strategies, and what do you do about that questions. So at the heart of the book is this fiscal math that says an increase in taxes plus a decrease in defense should equal an increase in social programs and redistribution. And there's a lot of logic to that, despite the fact that I do come from the business world. I will, however, say as a footnote, some well-meaning attempts to try to do that redistribution have failed in the United States. Many people, Democrats and Republicans, and well-minded ones as well, thought that the key to this, to a stable society, was home ownership. And U.S. government policy in many ways promoted home ownership, and we've seen some unfortunate outcomes of that. But I don't want to spend so much on the fiscal math as much as four or five of the points that were laid out in the book and proposals that that I found hard to understand. And some of these have to do with the virtue stuff and the mindfulness stuff. First, there's the huge body of literature about behavioral foibles, behavioral economics. At its core, the work suggests that we don't always make the best decisions that we can. And if we look at some of the things that Jeff rightfully points out are problems in American society, they run straight into these fundamental and, in fact, some would argue neurobiological phenomena. How exactly are we going to solve them? Overeating, watching too much TV, being distracted. I thought the diagnosis in the front was right. I found myself in the back, not quite understanding how fiscal redistribution will solve these problems. Second, in chapter 10, and you should read the whole book, it's really good. Jeff lays out the equivalent of a U.S. version of the Millennium Development Goals. It really is incredibly breathtaking. Reducing unemployment, increasing work benefits, improving education, reducing poverty, avoiding economic catastrophe, balancing the federal budget, improving corporate governance, and keeping national security high, and increasing happiness, all by 2020. So what I can't understand is how it is that in two presidential cycles, or the length of time that a popular TV show would run, that we're going to solve all these problems. I can't disagree that that's the right list, but I think we have to have a realistic set of timings. And to speak about that then, we need priorities. That list that you have in chapter 10 is exactly right, but what order do we tackle these things, and where do we put our priorities? For example, you rail against the democratic system and parts of the democratic system, not really railing against it, quite honestly, but acknowledging the defects in it. What specific things should we take on? For example, the Supreme Court decision in Citizens might be a great place to start. For those of you who don't, it treats corporations as if they're individuals and therefore gives them free right to finance political campaigns. In the final chapter, Jeff holds out hope for millennials. I have a 21-year-old daughter and I have great hope for her. Some of you are about that age from what I can tell. But I was at the tail end of another generation where there was much hope. I was born, actually had a ticket to the Woodstock Festival, if you know what that is. Although my mother wouldn't let me go. And the youth of the 1960s were hell-bent on changing the world, and they did for a while. So it is true that we should have hope for the millennials in changing the world, but it's not true that we can hope and think that that's going to be the end of the solution. Many of us found out that when we became parents, we became like our parents. And therefore, the notion that somehow this generation will permanently change society, I'm hopeful too, but I'm not quite sure. Finally, I would have hoped that Jeff could come up with a positive role for business in this equation. So when you read the book, and I read it as a business school dean, business is portrayed as the source of massive income inequalities, substitutions of capital for labor, leaving workers behind, overselling goods to unsuspecting consumers, not mindful of its impact on the economy, flexing its economic muscle in the political system, and some or all of that is to some degree true. At the same time, however, business is the engine of society. It creates jobs, it creates products, it creates services, and the source of innovation. Somehow in this economic calculus that we have, there must be a positive role for business. And that was missing in the discussion. And I don't disagree that there is time for a mixed economy a little bit more. As I said, I come from a freshwater economics tradition as well. But in this price for civilization, we have to make sure that this engine of growth for the economy doesn't somehow get forgotten. Thank you.
Great, Peter, thanks. Jeff is taking notes, and he won't have enough time to get back to everything, but I'm sure he'll address many of these very, very pertinent questions. Adrian.
Well, I've long admired Jeff's amazing ability to identify and address big problems, and I've also long admired his powers of focused argument and advocacy, and you saw them very much on display this evening. I also share many of his concerns about US civilization, and I have a lot of sympathy with many of his proposals. I think he and I are coming from the same sort of background. So America is in a terrible state, but it's amazing how many people want to move to live there. So it must look more attractive from the outside than it looks from the inside. And that's one of the things that makes me want to ask how many of the problems that Jeff is focusing on really are peculiar to America, and indeed, to what extent are his solutions peculiarly American solutions? And I guess I'm picking up here from Adam's comments. I mean, a full answer to this question of, you know, how much is this a story about the US and how much is this a story about other developed countries or the world would take a very long time to deliver. But think about a couple of the phenomena that have been picked on by Jeff and mentioned by Adam. And those are the distributional problems that arise from globalization. Globalization, very broadly defined to mean reduction of barriers to international transactions of all kinds. That's globalization narrowly defined, plus the rise of Asia, which is the, so you think of global eye, it's Asian, is what's going on. I don't think the US has, on average, lost from globalization. If you aggregate all social and economic groups together, the problems have been distributional. I mean, two big problems. One is this dramatic rise in top-end inequality, and you actually see this worldwide. You know, even in China, billionaires popping up all over the place. I don't think it's driven by some kind of institutional political conspiracy of some kind. I mean, there are real market forces going on here. Big market size amplifies the earning power of scarce talent. So that's one problem. The other problem is the wage and employment declines for less educated workers in developed countries. And this is not just a US problem. It prevails across the developed world. I mean, rising Asia has done very well in terms of the employment and wages of less educated workers. A lot of the rest of the world, as Jeff was pointing out at the beginning, the workers have just been left out of the globalization process and have done very badly as a result. So, I mean, these distributional problems are certainly shared by other developed countries. What about the solutions? Have we got the answers right? Is there an agreed set of answers in some sense to these problems? And here I think I have a lot of sympathy with one of the points that Adam was making. I don't think we've solved this problem in Europe. I mean, we have, you know, an undereducated underclass in these nice social democratic, well-managed 40% redistribution societies. We haven't cracked that problem. So I think there are genuine problems with European welfare states that one needs to address. I think, in a way, that the other point I should comment on Adam's remarks is that this big issue, well, if globalization is driving these problems, why don't we stop globalization? You know, why don't we put barriers to trade, foreign direct investment, and these things that are causing these changes in income inequality? And interestingly, you know, I think quite rightly, this is not something that Jeff is advocating. I mean, the perception is, in aggregate, this is a good process for the world as a whole. I mean, big gainers around the world. The issue is, how do you deal with the distributional problems? And I think, you know, we've failed on that. I don't think, as I say, there's an agreed policy agenda that we just need to get people to sign up to. I think there are genuine intellectual disagreements about what is the right way to crack these problems. The disagreements that Adam raised about globalization. I think there's a real disagreement too about Keynesian policies. I mean, you know, these were the policies that were subscribed to up to the point when Reagan and Thatcher ditched them along with a lot of other stuff. So it's, you know, I think there's a debate to be had there. So I don't know. But change is definitely needed in the US. There I absolutely agree with Jeff. Is Jeff going to be able to persuade enough people in the US to go along with him? I agree with him. Plutocracy is not going to be the problem. I mean, I had the same thought about the robber barons were overthrown in the 19th century. And I remember in 1967, Galbraith published a rather similar kind of book, The New Industrial State. And I think that did play a role in civilizing America, and I very much hope that Jeff's book does too. Thank you.
Great. Valpy.
I shall be brief, not only because we want to hear the opinions of this alleged new generation, but also because I've already exhausted most of my armory of intelligent remarks. I'd like to come back to this point in the title, the Wendell Holmes point, that direct taxation is central to Jeff's argument, both as a source of collective funding of public goods and as a means of redistributing income from the winners to the losers that Adrian was referring to in a democratic market economy. And specifically, it means redistributing income away from rents, capital incomes, or bankers' salaries, which in a sense, a large part are profit shares rather than wages in any meaningful sense, and towards labor. But my problem is that this debate in the US treats that economy as though it were a closed economy or a world unto itself, which I suppose is natural because it's very large, but also there's strains of sort of American exceptionalism that, you know, the US is somehow different, which is normal about all hegemonic states. The Romans felt that civilization was Rome. We felt that, you know, civilization was us. The French still feel civilization is them. Interestingly, America is now having doubts about it, but along come the Chinese, who clearly feel that, you know, objectively, civilization is us. But the point I wanted to make is that it's only when, and it's interesting this has been mentioned here, the only international force that's mentioned are all these Chinese workers undermining US manufacturing. I mean, the rest of the international scene doesn't really come in. Now, interestingly, the US, it is true that its trade and labor market terms, it is fairly self-contained, particularly if you see the US not as the US on this map, but the NAFTA, including Mexico and Canada. It really is virtually a closed economy and a closed labor market, if you would like to think of it that way. So one question is really, should this map be redrawn to include those two, which then raises a number of quite interesting issues to do that. Just as much as the map of Europe has been withdrawn redrawn in this sense. The second point I want is that we have, of course, not just free trade, but free capital movements and free profit movements around the world. This is the counterpart of the deregulation that Jeff was referring to within the US, referred to in the UK or anywhere else, but it's also meant global free movement of capital and profits. What this means is the capacity of any one country to actually tax higher incomes, right, from rents or from profits or from high executive salaries is enormously reduced thereby, right? So it's not just a question of political will about whether Obama can sort of get his act together, but or of corporations' pressure. It's that even if Roosevelt or his sort of 20th grandchild were to come back, the ability to tax those incomes is enormously reduced. And the issue, interestingly, is it's not about the tax rate being lower elsewhere, or the tax rate being near zero in the Cayman Islands. It's an issue of information. Right? That is to say, it's very difficult for tax authorities to find out what the assets are of their citizens held abroad. Right? So it's as much a matter of the tax base as it is of the tax rate. And this is really the big issue, that in some sense, capital has become denationalized in some sense. I mean, I'm not speaking sort of deep IR terms, but in the sort of simplistic view that economists have of the world, and this is a central issue. Now, economic theory tells us actually that tax is best levied on immobile factors, right? That you should tax immobile factors. Of course, the immobile factor is labor because we've set up these barriers to labor moving, and the mobile factor is capital. So it seems the only way to tax capital incomes and high executive salaries is by international cooperation to do that,
and to close down offshore financial centers, which include not only the Caymans and other nice warm places, but actually the two largest tax havens of the world are actually New York and London. Okay. So it's not a question of closing them down, but just that they don't report back to countries the assets being held over there. So I think there is a real need for international coordination. There's a real classical coordination problem, which I think has to be faced here. And so just to assume somehow that if you had the political will or you could do something about the corporations, then you'd be able to tax effectively and, you know, pay for civilization, I think is false. And I think I admire the book a lot, as I tried to say at the beginning, but I think its weakness in its strengths, as I think Adrian mentioned, was that it does take a particular society, right? But there is a weakness that it's not really addressing those sort of international issues.
Thanks very much, Valpy, and to all the panelists, who I think have done a really terrific job in reading the book extremely quickly and assimilating very pertinent points. I'm going to give Jeff just 5 minutes to respond. He's obviously not going to be able to pick up everything. He'll be able to chat to people afterwards, but I do want to give you all in the audience a few minutes to be able to get into a discussion with Jeff. So, Jeff, if you could select what you want and pick up some of the points.
Great. Thank you very much. I'm going to speak about the millennials first. And in defense of the Woodstock generation for a moment, which is that the reforms of the 1960s was another great era of democratization in the United States. Women's rights, sexual and reproductive rights, civil rights. It was a dramatic transformation. Then that same transformation messed up things later on. So all I'm claiming about the millennials is you can fix this. You will mess things up later on. And then you will turn to your own children's generation to fix things again. So I didn't want to make a general theory that somehow the millennials have come along and will uniquely break the flow of history of messing things up. I just wanted to claim that this is time for generational renewal. And the millennials know a lot about how to do that because you're better at tweeting things and Facebook and social networking and other mechanisms that I believe can be tactically and substantively extremely important in the new politics and actually break the hold of some of the existing entrenched interests. And that's what I take 11 weeks of street theater, in a sense, of the Occupy movement, which is wonderful. It's been brilliant. It has changed an enormous amount. And I don't mean street theater in a pejorative sense at all. I mean it as demonstrating to the country a kind of public education, which has been phenomenal. And so I was not trying to overpraise you. This was more a homework assignment. It's your turn now to fix things. It will be someone else's turn to clean up after you. That's called overlapping generations in our model. Second, let me say a word about business. I am a huge admirer of business, and I'm a huge admirer of capitalism in certain ways. Business is the repository of the best management in the world. It's the repository of cutting-edge technology, and I believe business is much better at foreign policy than our foreign offices and our state departments because a large company is much more adept at global politics than a typical foreign ministry is. Where I do not believe business has any right role to play at all is in Washington, at all. And the lobbying, the campaign contributions, the financing of campaigns, the corporate propaganda is nothing short of disgusting and wrecking our societies. So I'm not anti-business, and I'm certainly not anti-markets. And I'm not anti-capitalism, but what I am is in favor of boundaries. And the boundary that I would like is for business to understand its job is not to run the politics. Its job is to live within the rules of the game effectively, not to write the rules of the game. And this is a huge problem that is a fundamental problem of all economies, how to create proper barriers so that neither politics dominates the economy nor the economy dominates politics. And you can see when pathologies occur in both directions, and I argue that the pathology is business dominating politics right now. And we have less to worry about the Hayekian fear of a road to serfdom via totalitarian government than we do to fear the road to ruin from plutocracy right now. And so we have to get back to a proper balance and definition of roles, and that's really what I'm saying. Third, I'm not meaning to say, certainly not, that the distributional and pressure consequences of globalization are unique to the U.S. Quite the contrary, this is a generalized phenomenon. What I am saying is that different countries have responded in different ways. You're breaking my heart to tell me how many problems there are in Northern Europe. I absolutely don't want to hear about it. I want to believe, as I have for many decades, that Sweden, Denmark, Norway, Finland are wonderful places, and I'm afraid I'm going to continue to believe that. But I also do want to say that quantitatively, statistically, on many counts, they are wonderful places. Poverty is very, very low. Social mobility is much higher than in the United States. Level, indeed, of happiness, as measured by the self-report of life satisfaction, for example, is consistently higher in Northern Europe than it is in the rest. I apologize for a misunderstanding. I was not counting the UK and Northern Europe for these purposes. So I did not mean to get your hopes up. You are firmly in the Anglo-Saxon world that you created on my continent. That is a world that has had a very big trouble getting the right balance of markets, government, social democracy, and so forth. We are the relatively market side of the equation, and so many of the syndromes of the US and the UK are similar in the last 30 years. Our politics run in parallel. It is a unique relationship of exchange of ideas. Thatcher, Reagan, again, Blair, Bush, Blair Clinton and Blair Bush. This is not an accident. We share the same space, ideas, world. We also share Rupert Murdoch and other public bads and ills. But the UK has something the US doesn't have, for example, and that's NHS. The UK is not as far to the market excess and lack of public goods as the U.S. is. This is really a major difference. So I would argue, I really do argue, and this is a point that I would choose to defend, that there are different variants of capitalism, and that the more market-based capitalism right now is the less successful of the capitalisms in the balance of three propositions, which is prosperity, equity, and sustainability. And I think that we're doing less well. One could argue that prosperity is higher in the U.S., though I somehow doubt that, in productivity, I should say. The U.S. has had a higher per capita income of about a 30% advantage relative to Europe since 1870. My view is that we have a lot more land, a lot more resources, we have bigger houses, bigger cars, and that this actually is pretty, and even before we had cars, we had bigger carriages, have bigger land rents and resource rents. And I don't really see the social institutions as being the main determinant of the difference of per capita incomes between the US and Europe, the average incomes. I see this as somehow the difference of countries that are about one order of magnitude different in population density. In the U.S., it's about 30-some population per square kilometer, I guess, if I have the numbers right, but I may have the number wrong, so I don't want to be quoted, and roughly tenfold higher in Europe. And this makes a difference in measurement and so on, not in quality of life, I believe, but in measurement of per capita GNP. And I don't really see, so I think we're really losing on the equity side, we're really losing on the sustainability side, and I think it's arguable whether there's any loss of social democracy on the productivity side. My argument would be that instead of thinking of this as a efficiency equity trade-off is the standard way, that actually there is no trade-off in the fundamental sense that more equity means higher average investment in human capital. And I believe that Scandinavia still leaves many fewer kids behind than the United States does. And I think that that's the notable, most important investment that a society has to make is in its children. The American system is leaving large numbers of children behind with very little hope to get out of poverty, with very little hope to get lifetime skills that are adequate to the 21st century. And that's where I take the fundamental challenge. Finally, I think that the point about whether any system of decency can survive in an age of globalization is a real question. In other words, will social democracy be eaten away either by capital mobility, or will it get eaten away by in-migration, which breaks homogeneous societies and undermines the social basis for the high solidaristic approaches of those countries? Or is it impossible for the U.S. to collect more than 1.5 percentage points of national income and corporate taxation, the lowest level in the last 40 years? These are absolutely valid questions. Does globalization so tie the hands of government that I'm just looking back with nostalgia at a different time, and it's not possible now? And my argument is no, but it does depend on the view that cooperation between countries and global governance can also and also has to play a role. So I am, you know, something of an idealist in that regard. And my preceding book called Commonwealth was about global governance and the belief that it can take hold. When it comes to tax havens and so on, it's absolutely correct that we need global cooperation to crack down on tax havens. It's also utterly correct that New York and London are two places to start, and they play against each other to make sure that nothing happens right now. It's the UK and the US that are blocking the financial transactions tax, for example, which I also subscribe to. Probably the best book in recent years on this is by Nick Jackson called Treasure Islands. It's a horrifying tale of the role of the UK and the US in creating the world of tax havens. The Caymans doesn't just spring up somehow knowing how to exercise every loophole of American corporate governance. These are created by powerful interests, and they're created by politicians, and they're created by the companies themselves, and they've been created largely by the UK and the US. The abuses are so startling that when you read about them, they do make you shiver understand how such flagrant violations of basic norms could be tolerated. When in the Caymans, for example, some individuals sit on hundreds of boards because everybody registers in the Cayman Islands as a tax haven. There are no employees there, but international profits are booked there for tax-free status. And since the Caymans do not have many people, they each have to sit on hundreds of boards so that they can exercise proper corporate governance, you know, in order for these tax-avoiding strategies to hold. And maybe if you'll permit me 1 minute just to explain one of them to show you how egregious it is. It involves one of our leading companies, but there are many examples. This one just happens to be very well documented in public, and that's Google. Google books all its international profits in Bermuda. And the way they do that is that they have an agreement with the IRS, by the way, and the agreement is that the intellectual property of Google, you'll be surprised to know, for all international operations actually resides in Bermuda. That's where it belongs. And the international operations are centered in Dublin, where the corporate tax rate is the lowest in Europe. But have no fear, the corporate tax rate still is around 12%, I believe, in Dublin, but Google doesn't really pay 12% there, because what it does is it collects all its international revenues into the Dublin holding company for Google, and then it makes a lump sum multi-billion dollar transfer to Bermuda to pay for intellectual property, which conveniently was made by brilliant computer scientists in Bermuda, no doubt on their summer holidays from Palo Alto, where this otherwise process was taking place during the winter months. That is how Google pays very low taxes. And this is approved by law. This is not some illegal operation. This is approved by the International Revenue, the Internal Revenue Service. It is the International Revenue Service also, at your service.